Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and today we are going to start with our daily current affairs for 17th of February 2021. All right, so these classes are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination conducted by the UPSC. All right, as well as other government competitive examinations, because you people require, you know, to solve certain questions related to the daily current affairs. And UPSC is fond of asking these questions for right in the various examinations, specifically the civil services examination. And you would be probably reading the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express for your enrichment of your day-to-day current affairs. And here on the Future IAS channel, you can subscribe this channel on the YouTube, where we are also bringing the day-to-day related current affairs on the daily basis on this channel. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube and you will get the daily current affairs related lecture. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right, so first is Article 153. Article 153 in the Constitution of India.
Okay,
so now what is the significance of Article 153 in the today's news? The Kiran Bedi, who was basically, you know, the lieutenant governor of the Pondicherry, she was basically removed. She was basically removed, right, from the post of the lieutenant governor of Pondicherry. The Pondicherry is basically a union territory, which is having the legislative assembly with it. Okay, so there are only three union territories which are having legislative assembly with them: the Jammu and Kashmir, Delhi, and the Pondicherry. Okay, so Pondicherry is one among them, and Kiran Bedi was basically the lieutenant governor of Pondicherry. Okay, and her charge was given to the Telangana governor, Dr. Tamil Sai Soundarajan, right, who have been given the additional charge of the lieutenant governorship of Pondicherry. Okay, now the article, what is Article 153? The Article 153 says that there shall be a governor for each state. Okay, but the Article 153 itself also says that there can be, you know, a same person can be a governor for the two or more states. That means the president can appoint, okay, the same person as the governor of two or more states. Or if the governor is removed from a particular state, the governor to the adjacent state can be given, right, an additional charge of the governorship of a particular state. So that is what is done, right? As soon as the Pondicherry lieutenant governor was removed, the Telangana governor have been given the additional charge of the lieutenant governor of Pondicherry. Okay, so that is how this Article 153 is in the news, okay, which is basically related to the governorship of every state. And in the case of, you know, a single person can be a governor of two or more states. So that means the single person can be given the additional portfolio or additional charge of the lieutenant governor of a particular union territory also. All right, next, E Chhavni. Chhavni means cantonment. Okay, it is a Hindi word that's called cantonment. So E Chhavni, okay, so it is basically a portal which was recently launched by the Defense Minister Rajnath Singh. Okay, so it is basically a portal and the mobile app which was recently launched by the Defense Minister Rajnath Singh on the February 16, 2021. Okay, now why this portal have been launched, that is called E Chhavni or the mobile app? This portal would basically, you know, serve the residents of the cantonment, right, basically the civic, you know, facilities. So those people who reside in the cantonment areas, right, would be able to access, right, or would be able to avail the basic facilities or basic civic facilities, right, specifically 62 cantonment boards across the country. So there are around 62 cantonment boards, and in the cantonment board, right, the cantonment boards are basically, you know, a mechanism to govern the local area, right? So the people who basically resides in the cantonment board, so there will be a resident to govern that area. The cantonment boards have been set up. Okay, so it is basically a form of urban government where the Ministry of Defense basically set up a cantonment boards. Okay, so to facilitate those residents who reside in the cantonment boards, the online civic services have been started with the help of E Chhavni, which is a portal as well as the mobile app. Through that portal, right? The residents of the cantonments basically can avail the basic civic services. For example, if they want to renew their lease, right? If they want to apply for the birth and the death certificates, they can apply through that portal, right? Or if they want any sort of a water connection or sewerage connections, they can apply for that, okay? If they want trade licenses, right? So they can basically apply through this portal or the mobile app. So various types of basic services have been availed by, you know, will be availed by the citizens or will be availed by the residents of these cantonment boards across the country. This basically portal was jointly developed by the e-government foundation, Bharat Electronics Limited, Directorate General Defense Estate, and the National Informatics Center. So it is basically, you know, would be specifically used only by the residents of the cantonment board, okay, which will facilitate the, you know, the service delivery to those, you know, residents who reside within the cantonment board itself. So it is not applicable to those people who does not reside basically in the cantonment boards offline. So it is basically, in the Hindi word, you can say e-chhavni means it is basically, you know, electronic service delivery of the civic services to the residents of the cantonment board will be provided through the portal or through the app. All right. Next, the Marsh mission. Okay. So various countries basically are competing against each other regarding the Marsh mission, regarding their own, they are sending their own, you know, the rovers basically to the Marsh, right? So that they can find out if any sort of a possibility regarding the, you know, the human habitation or any possibility regarding the water or, you know, any other life supporting gases can be found in the Marsh. Ultimate aim is to find out whether the human can sustain in the Marsh environment or not. Okay, the two countries are basically competing for that. Recently, the USA and the China, both countries have sent their own, you know, the missions to the Marsh. So the NASA or National Aeronautics Space Administration, that is the USA's main space administration agency, has sent the Perseverance mission to the Marsh. The China has sent the Tianwen first mission to the Marsh. Both are supposed to land, right? The USA's or the NASA's Perseverance mission is supposed to land on the Marsh on February 18th. Right, which is very near, that is tomorrow, and the China's Tianwen 1 mission is going to land on the May 21, 2021 respectively. Okay, now let's understand what is NASA's Perseverance rover mission. Okay, so it is, first of all, you must understand, it is a NASA's fourth generation Mars rover. It will be, you know, it will be land on the surface of the Mars. Okay, so this there will be a rover. Okay, this will basically move on the surface of the Marsh. Okay, so this is now en route to the Marsh, and it will be land at the Z0 crater. The Z0 crater where the NASA scientists have been found, right, likelihood of the water that was there in the past, right? So this, you know, the rover will find out if any possibilities of the water on the Marsh surface, as well as it will also try to find out if there is any other possibilities of finding the life supporting environment on the Marsh also. So the NASA's Perseverance rover would land at Z0 crater, which at one point of the time was having the water in the past also. Okay, the NASA's Perseverance mission would have the fourth generation Mars rover. Okay, this rover would look for the biosignatures, especially in the dried up lake. Okay, because there some clues was there that there was a water filled in that Z0 crater. Okay, so it will look at the biosignatures of the dried up lake. Okay, what was the reason of the drying up of the lake, if that lake consisting of the water at some point of the time. Okay, the China's Tianwen 1 mission, this is the China's first mission to the Marsh. Okay, it has, you know, successfully underwent the orbital insertion on the orbit of the Marsh on the February 10, okay? But there is significant difference between the two missions, okay? The, you know, the USA's Perseverance mission or the NASA's rover would directly enter and land on the surface of the Marsh. But the Tianwen, you know, one mission basically, first of all, it will roam, right? It will take, you know, some, you know, few months. So it will basically, you know, circulate around, you know, the marsh for the few months, and then it will attempt to land on the surface of the marsh in the month of May this year itself. Okay. So that is the, that is what the approach for the landing of a rover with respect to the NASA's Perseverance mission and with respect to the Tianwen-1 mission is somewhat different. Okay. So it is the, it is showing the parts of, or different, you know, parts of the rover. So you can see basically the SuperCam, which is basically having the laser micro imaging imager, which will basically, you know, try to collect the images. Then you have the MastCam Z, which is a zoomable, you know, the Panasonic camera, which is fitted with that. Then you have, for the media, you have the weather station, right, to find out any sort of a weather related, you know, the important, you know, the basically elements. And then you have, right, spectrometer also. Then you have, you know, certain set of producing, you know, which produce oxygen from Martian CO2, right? So it will basically conduct various experiments on the surface of the marsh, right? The scientists from the NASA would be able to find out if there is any possibility of converting the Martian CO2 into the oxygen. Okay, if there is any possibility of finding out the optimum weather for the sustenance of the human population on the marsh. Okay, so it will have different type of instrument fitted with that rover. Okay, then the Indian Sign Language Dictionary. So here, the third edition of the Indian Sign Language, you know, the dictionary was released by the Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment. It is the third edition. That means the first two edition was already launched, right? So it is basically the third such edition of Indian Science Language or Indian Sign Language Dictionary. This third edition of Indian Sign Language Dictionary has 10,000 items. The 10,000 items, that means that include the 6,000 previous, you know, items also, or previous terms. So the first two edition have 6,000 terms, and this third edition include 4,000 more. So it has total 10,000 terms related to the sign language, right? So this, you know, dictionary have been brought by the Indian Sign Language Research and the Training Center, right? This Indian Science Language Research and the Training Center is an autonomous institute under the Department of Empowerment of the Persons with the Disability, that is called Divyang Jan. Okay. Ultimate aim is to empower the persons with the disability, right? In terms of, right, they can, right, because there are a lot of issues with respect to the persons with the disability. They cannot read, they cannot hear, right? So with the sign language dictionary, they will be easily, right, it will be easily for the persons with the disability to understand, to speak, to learn the Indian languages with the help of these sign dictionaries. Obviously, the Indian Sign Language Research and the Training Center basically is an autonomous institute under Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, which is bringing such, you know, third edition of the dictionary, especially for the persons with the physically disability or the persons with the disability, which we call also call them the Divyang Jan. Okay. So it will be the third edition of, right, dictionary, which contains currently 10,000 terms. So first two, you know, edition of the dictionary basically consisting of, the first one consisting of 3,000 terms. The first edition of the dictionary was launched on the 31st March 2018. This first edition consisting of 3,000 terms. The second edition basically consisting of another 3,000. Okay, so total is 6,000 terms. Now the third edition consisting of 10,000 terms. That means 4,000 additional terms have been added to this year's third edition dictionary, especially for the use of for the persons with the disability. They can easily grasp, you know, certain terms which have been enumerated in the dictionary. Okay, so these terms are basically, you know, for those people who are disabled, so they can use for their day-to-day use. They can use for the academic terms, right? They have the legal and the administrative terms also. They have the medical terms, technical terms, and the agricultural terms. So obviously, the aim of, you know, bringing this dictionary is to empower the people, right, who have certain set of disability. They cannot read and write, right? In that perspective, this dictionary would ultimately help them, right, to overcome certain difficulties related to the disabilities, and that will be used, right, basically the regional signs in the different parts of the country. So this dictionary also contains the regional signs which are generally used in the different parts of the country, and that will help the people from the different regions to understood the sign in their own regional languages. All right. Next, the technographies. Okay, so technographies is basically, you know, a module which was launched by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. So that is called MOHUA. So it is a basically a module, right, for, you know, for the purpose of the bringing the changes in the, you know, construction of, you know, basically the lighthouse projects or the amenities which is related to the accommodation related need. Okay, so it will have basically the model housing projects as well as allied associated infrastructure, right, which will be used for, you know, for the purpose of habitation. So the technographies basically are the students from the leading institutions like IITs, NITs, right? It will have, you know, basically, you know, the planning and architectural colleges also will be involved. It will also involve the faculty members, academicians, as well as the other stakeholders from the industries. Okay. The Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs basically is promoting the 6 lighthouse projects. Okay. Each lighthouse project will have several thousand, right, houses. So that means each lighthouse project will have at least 1,000 houses. Okay, and associated, you know, infrastructure that will help in, you know, alleviation of the housing shortage related problems as well as other technical related problems that we are facing with respect to the construction of the houses. Okay, so such 6 lighthouse project, right, basically would be used as a model for the development of these, you know, the housing facilities with the help of, you know, certain set of transferring of the technology to the field. Okay, so here through the lighthouse project, you will be having the live laboratories that will be transferring the technology directly to the field level, and that will be useful for the development of habitations. So the lighthouse project are basically the model housing projects which will be, you know, which will having the different stakeholders like students from the leading institutions, IITs and NITs, the faculty, academicians, research scholars, and other stakeholders from the industry. Okay. At each location or at each lighthouse project will have, you know, around 1,000 houses. These 1,000 houses would basically, you know, will be built along with the allied infrastructure facilities. Okay. Now the interested candidates who want to, you know, learn through this lighthouse project, they can basically register themselves, right, to visit these 5 laboratories or these live laboratories at the 6 places that will be set up at these 6 lighthouse project sites. Okay, for various purpose, for learning purpose, for the consultation purpose, right, for the generation of the ideas, for the solutions, for experimentation, for innovation, and for technical awareness. That means it is basically, you know, the laboratory based the, you know, the construction project where the, you know, the technology would be, you know, enabled, right, at the grassroots level, right, the technology will be transferred to the grassroots level, and that will basically enable the government to alleviate the shortage of the houses in that respect. Okay, till the completion of these lighthouse projects within the period of 12 months, right, these technographies will get the regular updates from the sites of for the information dissemination that will help in finding out the state of art solution for the various housing related projects. Okay, next, the pilot PAYJAL survekshan, right? So it is basically a pilot PAYJAL survekshan. It is a pilot project which was launched by the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs, right, under the Jal Jeevan Mission Urban. So under Jal Jeevan Mission, the pilot project or pilot PAYJAL project, a pilot PAYJAL survekshan project was basically launched by the Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs. Okay, and this PAYJAL survekshan basically conducted especially in the cities, because the Jal Jeevan Mission urban shows that the Jal Jeevan Mission, which is implemented in the urban area, so obviously we are taking only the cities. Okay, so this survekshan would be conducted in the cities, right, that will ascertain, right, what is the need of this PAYJAL survekshan, why we are doing this survekshan. Okay, so we are doing this survekshan to ascertain, right, the exact quantity of the water that is available. Okay, then you must also promote through this survekshan the equitable distribution of the water among the residents, right? So ultimate aim is to equitably distribute this water among the people. Reuse of the wastewater. Ultimate aim is to reuse the wastewater through this, the Jal Sarvekshan and mapping of the water bodies so that the better planning can be done with respect to the availability of the water, and that will be used for alleviation of the water shortage, especially in the urban areas, right? With respect to the quantity and the quality of the water, right? Through a challenge process. Okay. Now, the ministry has decided to launch this survey in the 10 cities initially. Okay. These 10 cities have been chosen for this survey. The Agra, Badlapur, Bhubaneswar, Churu, Kochi, Madurai, Patiala, Rohtak, Surat and Tumkur. Surat and Tumkur. These are the 6 cities have been chosen for this pilot Jal Sarvekshan project. Okay. The Jal Jeevan Mission Urban, under which this Sarvekshan or this pilot project have been initiated or have been launched by the Ministry of Urban, Ministry of Housing and the Urban Affairs, right? The Jal Jeevan Mission is basically, it is designed to provide the universal coverage of water supply. Okay. Because there is shortage of the water, right? Especially in the city areas. And there is also, there are various houses which does not have the, the piped water connection. Okay. So ultimate aim is to provide the universal coverage, right, of the water supply to every household in the cities. Okay. That also ensured that every household will have the functional taps, right? Through the water, through the functional taps, the water will come out. Okay. These Jal Jeevan Mission urban projects will be implemented in all 4,378 statutory towns, right? In accordance with the Sustainable Development Goal 6. So ultimate aim is to provide the universal coverage of water supply to every household in the cities. Okay. The outlay for this project, the Jal Jeevan Mission Urban, is around 2,87,000 crore rupees. Okay. This 2,87,000 crore rupees includes the 10,000 crore rupees also for the continuation of the financing support under the Amrut Mission, which will also help in, the alleviation of, the water shortage, especially in the urban areas. All right. So this is basically a banner. You can see the budget 2022 basically provides the Pejal Sarvekshan pilot project, right? The pilot cities have been chosen. That is Rohtak, Agra, Surat, Badlapur, Tumkur, Kochi, Madurai, Bhubaneswar, Churu, right? And Patiala. Okay. So it is basically, launching at 1 p.m. on the 16th February 2021. It is a first step towards, the finding of or the assessing of the real, the availability of the water so that it can equitably available, right, to all the residents of the cities, right? It can equitably distribute, so that you can reuse the water, right? Mapping the water bodies, right, with respect to the qualitative as well as the quantitative assessment of the availability of the water, especially in the city areas. Okay. Then Sahaj Marg. What is the Sahaj Marg? So Sahaj Marg was basically given by, given by the Sri Ramachandra, right? So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would address the event which was organized, right, to commemorate the 75 years of Sri Ramachandra Mission. So Sri Ramachandra was basically, a spiritual leader who was born in 1899 and who died in 1983, right? Under his guidance, the Sri Ramachandra Mission was initiated. Okay. So it was the Sahaj Marg was, given by the Sri Ramachandra, who was, gave the important form of the yoga, which is also known as the Raja Yoga. So through the Raja Yoga, the Sahaj Marg was basically given to the people, which is also known as the natural path, It is basically a meditation system, which involved the meditation, cleaning and the prayer, right? So all three elements were part of the Raja Yoga. Okay, the cleaning of impressions, means samskaras, right? Which is unique to this method, right? The organization body, which basically conduct, right, this type of Raja Yoga was known as the Sri Ramachandra Mission, right? Which is formally registered in 1945 by the Ramachandra itself. Right. And he was basically given the Raja Yoga, or he was basically, gave this Sahaj Marg or the natural path, right, which is a part of the meditation system or which is a part of spiritual practice, right, which will be a technique which is also called the pranauti, which is taught by this, which is taught by his spiritual master itself, that was Lalaji. So through this spiritual practice, he basically, you know, adopted this technique, which is also known as pranauti, which was taught to the Ramachandra by his guru itself. The guru's name was Lalaji. Okay, so he was basically Ramachandra. Okay, next, the Rashtrapati Bhavan Krida Sthal. Okay, so in the premises of the Rashtrapati Bhavan, okay, the renovated football ground and the basket court have been recently inaugurated. Okay, so the basket ground and the football ground was basically renovated. The President of India inaugurated, right, the Rashtrapati Bhavan's Krida Sthal, or the playing ground, right, which was recently renovated and basically, you know, inaugurated by the President of India itself, right, which is located in the President Estate on the 16th February 2021. Okay, now this Krida Sthal, or you know, the complex or the playing complex, basically consisting of the state of art sport facilities, okay, which are developed. The ultimate aim is to cater to the needs of the employees of the Rashtrapati Bhavan. Okay, so the employees which are working in the Rashtrapati Bhavan, their families, right, to cater the needs of those employees and their families, the state of art sports facility have been developed, right, in the President Estate itself. It has been recently renovated, right, as a football ground and a basketball court. Okay, on this ground, right, various interdepartmental football tournament also conducted. Okay, the interdepartmental football tournament, right, for those, you know, employees which are working the Rashtrapati Bhavan, consisting of around 5 teams, right, which is basically the President's Secretariat Heroes, the Household Youngs, the PVG Warriors, the Army Guard Daredevils, and the Delhi Police Stalwarts, right? These are the 5 teams which will be participating in the interdepartmental football tournament. And you must understand, right, this state-of-art sports facilities will be used, right, by the employees of the Rashtrapati Bhavan and their families. An ultimate aim is to encourage the employees and their families to participate in the events, or especially in the sports event, who are working with the Rashtrapati Bhavan. So this is basically ground which was recently, you know, recently was renovated. Okay. Then bridges in the Assam. Okay. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would visit the Assam on the 18th February. Okay. And on his visit, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would also lay the foundation stone to the Dhuburi Fulbari village. The Dhuburi basically in the Assam and Fulbari in the Meghalaya. So there is a river which is flowing, that is called Brahmaputra. So on the Assam side, there is called Dhuburi. And on the Fulbari, it is basically on the Meghalaya side. On the Meghalaya side, okay. So the Assam and the Meghalaya, okay. So these two places will be joined. These two places will be joined through the bridge, okay. For that, the foundation stone would be laid by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi on the 18th February, okay. On that, he will also perform the Bhumi Pujan for the construction of the Majuli Bridge in the Assam on the 18th February, okay. So here, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would, you know, lay the foundation stone for the 4-lane bridge that will be constructed across the Brahmaputra River, right, between the Dhuburi, which is located on the northern bank in the Assam region, and Fulbari, which is located in the southern bank in the Meghalaya region. Okay, this Dhuburi-Fulbari bridge, which is a 4-lane bridge, which will basically cross, or which is located, or which will be located across the Brahmaputra River. This proposed bridge would be located on the National Highway 127B. Okay, this National Highway 127B would originating from Sri Rampur on the National Highway 27 East-West Corridor, and it will be terminating on the Nong Stoin on the National Highway 106 in the state of Meghalaya. Okay, and this will connect basically the Dhuburi in the Assam to the Meghalaya region, specifically the Fulbari, Tura, Rongram, and the Rongjiang region of the Meghalaya. All right. And regarding the Majuli Bridge, also the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would perform the Bhumi Puja, right? The Majuli Bridge, basically the Majuli Island is a riverine island, which is the world's largest riverine island, which is formed by the Brahmaputra River, right? The Majuli Bridge, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would perform the Puja, right, for the 2-lane bridge that will be constructed on the Brahmaputra River, right, between the Majuli, which is on the northern bank, and the Jorhat, which is basically in the southern bank. So this bridge also will connect the north and the southern bank of the Brahmaputra River. This bridge or the Majuli Bridge will be located on the National Highway 715K, right, which will connect the Nimati Ghat on the Jorhat side, right, with the Kalambari on the Majuli side of the island, which is basically located across the Majuli Island, right, on the Brahmaputra River. All right. So here you can see the Brahmaputra River is flowing, okay, and across the Brahmaputra River, the four-lane dedicated, you know, bridge will be constructed on the Dhuvri and the Fulwari side of Meghalaya. All right. Then the Mahababu, right, Brahmaputra, right. So what is the Mahababu Brahmaputra? So here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi will launch the Mahababu Brahmaputra in the Assam on 18th February 2021 during his visit. Okay. So here the launch of Mahababu Brahmaputra would be, you know, would be marked by various inaugurations of, first of all, the vessel operations, which is also known as RoPax vessel operations, which are conducted or which are conducted in the Brahmaputra, especially between the Nimati and Majuli Islands, the North Guwahati and South Guwahati, and between the Dhuvri and Hastingmari, right, as well as the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would be also doing the Silanyas of the inland water transport terminal, which will be constructed at the Jogi Jopa and various other tourist jetties on the river Brahmaputra, right? The ultimate aim of doing all such things is providing the digital solutions for the ease of doing business, specifically on the Brahmaputra River. Okay, the program which basically aimed at providing the connectivity, right, to those people who resides, right, across the Brahmaputra River, because crossing the Brahmaputra River is a big hurdle, right, for those people who resides across the Brahmaputra River. If you ever visit the Assam or Guwahati region, right, you will wonder the people used to cross the river through the boats or through that boats which are not, you know, safe enough, right? So these boats are not very safe to connect those people who resides across, you know, the Brahmaputra, and to provide the seamless connectivity to the eastern part of India, right? Right, this project will be implemented, right? So various developmental activities would be implemented on the Brahmaputra River as well as on the river Barak. Okay, so that's all for the today. We will meet again tomorrow for our next news. So till then, thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet again tomorrow. Thank you very much.